Well, good morning and welcome to St. John's. If you're visiting with us, we're glad you're here with us. Please make yourself known to us and to our ushers and greeters so we can give you a little gift. And also today, just a reminder that Vacation Bible School has started, so the kids are welcome to go down into Skip Church and have fun down there. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Opening baptismal sentences are found in your order of service. There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's all of us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, You know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not and for our blindness we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Jesus, as fully God and fully man, is able to provide a full and sufficient sacrifice for the whole world. Disciples who are called to join in similar sacrifice are blessed. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians. Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him, God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether in heaven or on earth, by making peace through the blood of his cross. I, Paul, became a servant of this gospel. I am now rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh, I am completing what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church. I became its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known. The mystery that has been hidden throughout the ages and generations, but has now been revealed to his saints. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is he whom we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
As Jesus and his disciples went on their way, Jesus entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." The Gospel of the Lord.
Go where your best prayers take you, and clench the fists of your spirit and take it easy. Breathe deeply of the glad air and live one day at a time. Know that you are precious and learn to trust.
Amen.
Amen. Isn't that a lovely hymn? So the day dawned for me. It's one of our new ones, and we're continuing to learn it, but we will sing it again. What great lyrics, what great theology. Hope you all are having a great summer and enjoying your summer. I started the beginning of summer saying that to you, to take some time, break your patterns, shake things up a little bit, slow down, have an adventure. Skip church if you need to connect with your friends and family. What are y'all doing here this morning? In other words, you know, really take care of yourself. Summer's a great time to do that. It's not the only season to do that. But we don't think of it enough, I think. And I had one of those opportunities just a little over a week ago to reconnect with some friends and extended family. My wife threw a party. Well, it's not exactly a party. Those of you who are kind of around our age probably know it's an old-fashioned thing. I guess it's old-fashioned. It's called a sip and see. It's where the proud grandmother gets to show off her new granddaughter. So that's what we did. And as Al Bettinger says, I was thinking, oh, voila, I get a yard pass. I said, I'll go to the golf course. She said, oh, no, it's co-ed. I said, oh, okay, well, whatever. I thought I was out of there. No, it didn't happen. But it turned out to be marvelous. Because truly, one of my favorite things, that's not true. My favorite things is to have people into my home. And I like going into other people's homes. There is something magic about it. And I would have people over all the time because I'm extremely extroverted. That's probably not a great thing. But I know at this sip and see where, you know, it's kind of for ladies and not much for men, what ultimately happened is what always happens. When friends get together in a house, the conversation just gets deeper. People start connecting. I had more fun watching people connect and listening to stories and watching people catch up with each other. It's just something very powerful about it. You know, we focus on each other more when we're in each other's homes. There's a different level of conversation. There's nothing wrong with going out. I go out to eat all the time. But there is a whole other level of something that transpires. We get caught up in each other a bit, in a really good way. We slow down a little bit with each other in a really good way. It is very therapeutic. And you know, younger people who have been raised on going out to eat are catching on. I don't know if you've noticed, I've really noticed how many younger people are writing books about this very thing. Eating at home, cooking with their family, having people into their home rather than going out. There's kind of this trend back to that, and a lot of research being done about it. Well, we know what the research says. It's not to put down a new discovery, but we know what it means, don't we? When we dine with each other or eat with your family, there's some deeper sense of belonging that's created. It creates a community, particularly people who are not related to each other. There's great evidence that actually, if you can get people who are struggling into a home setting, something more equal happens between them. We're not surprised by that, are we? Our perspective changes as we listen and talk and share. I think we find common ground. I think what we do is rediscover that we are actually way more alike one another than different. And it takes a lot sometimes for us to get there. You know, after all, it's not an absent point, is it, that in many societies, doing this simple thing, eating together in one's home, is considered sacred. Sacred. It is holy. It is considered a holy event, like it was for Jesus in Jesus' day. And if you travel to Palestine or Israel today, you will find the same in that old world culture, that if you're brought into someone's home for a meal, you're not a guest. It's deeper. You become family. And see, that's where the sacredness is. We get this deep sense of belonging to each other. And that's exactly our gospel story today. Mary and Martha, the sisters, good friends of Jesus, simply have him over for dinner. Don't make it more than it is. That is all that's happening. He comes to dinner. They're good friends. In fact, they're the significant relationship referred to on many occasions in the gospel, that he is friends with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. As the meal progresses, Mary becomes so comfortable being with Jesus that she forgets she's a host. She becomes like a guest to her sister, Martha, who's doing all the work. And Martha is obviously not too happy about it. We get that. That happens. But thinking about the story, can you imagine having Jesus at your dinner table? Well, you can. We all can. Because, see, that's part of the message today. The story is asking us a question. Do we take Jesus home with us the way that Mary and Martha do? Do we take him home? Do we take him home with us? And when we do, what happens? Fred Craddock, the brilliant preacher and minister who wrote so much, preached so much, helped so many people learn to preach, know how to preach, was a young Methodist minister in West Tennessee and had a small church there in a West Tennessee town. It was an active, busy place. And he said he remembered this one little girl so distinctly. Her name was Cynthia. She's this gorgeous child. She was about 7. She never saw the parents, but the little girl was always in Sunday school. And that went on for a long time when he first went to the church. And one day he was trying to figure out where she come from. She just kind of arrives. So he went out to the front of the church and they had a circular drive. He said they probably had the circular drive for the parents who didn't stay for church, but anyway, dropped their kids off. Anyway, so he went out and sure enough, the parents, really nice people, drove up. They actually got out of the car, kissed their daughter. She went in church, they got in their car, went away. So he bothered after Sunday school to go back, look, sure enough, the parents come back, pick her back up, go back home. He thought that was interesting. He knew the parents. They were in that way that we speak in the South, that up-and-coming young couple from the North who'd been assigned to the factory in town, and he was the president and moving up the chain of command. And he said, everybody knew it. They were a lovely young couple. They had a party every Saturday night. Biggest party in town every Saturday night. They had a ton of people in their home. They had drink, food, great parties, great fun, music. But they never went to church. On Sunday, they brought their daughter. He said it didn't bother him. He and his wife had been to their house for some parties. He said it was great. They were great, great fun. He didn't think much about this, just what they did. Until one Sunday, they showed up for church. And he looked up, and there they are sitting with their child. They didn't pick her up from Sunday school. They actually parked their car and came inside. And then when he greeted them when they were leaving, they said, can we see you after church? And he said, well, yeah. He said, it's great to have you. He said, no, we really need to talk. So he's thinking, boy, I wonder what's going on. So he said, well, let me get things. And they said, well, Cynthia can play out on the playground with some of the kids, and if we could go to your study. So they went down to his study. And they said, actually, it's kind of simple. We want to give our lives to Jesus. And he said, you do? Okay, that's great. That's great. Don't get me wrong. But can you tell me kind of what brought this on? What happened? And so the parents told him the story. They said, we do these great parties on Friday, on Saturday night, and you've been to some of them. Fabulous. We have more fun doing it. It's really our life. That's what we do. We do this great party on Saturday night. We have people in every Saturday night. And, you know, we did this about a week ago again, and, you know, a lot of times we stay up a little late and we play the music a little loud, we'll drink a little too much, everybody's there, and then they go home. And he said, you know, about three-quarters of the way through the evening, we looked up and Cynthia, we had awakened her, and she came down the stairs, and she was standing on the landing. And she said, they said it kind of stopped the party. And Cynthia had a big grin. She loved being down there with the adults. And she looked and she said, food. She said, can I say the blessing? And she did, right there. God is great. God is good. Let us thank him for our food. Amen. And she said, good night. I'm going to go back to bed. He said, in about 5 minutes, everybody went home. He said, you know, we're cleaning up and we're thinking about it. And he said, my wife and I weren't talking. We were in our heads, and he said, we looked at each other, and we were struck by something. He said, we didn't even need to say it. He said, so we're here this morning. Jesus talked all the time. I have this refrain in my brain from childhood to adulthood. Jesus talked over and over, wait and watch. Wait and watch. And I have to tell you, for a long time, I wondered what it meant. Then I kind of took it, I didn't like it much, because it's almost like, you know, for people trying to live their faith, it's almost a little bit of a put down. What do you mean, wait and watch? I'm seeing this, I'm here, I'm connected. What do you mean, wait and watch? And as I've gotten older, I've thought a lot about it, and working with you and all of us doing spiritual work together, it finally hit me that I was interpreting it, I had a wrong interpretation. I don't think he was saying wait and watch so that we'll see God when he comes into your life. I don't think that's what he meant. He understood that God is in our lives all the time. I think what he meant was very simple. Wait and watch your life. Wait and watch your life, not someone else's. And then, we know what he meant. See God. See God at work. Tell you a wonderful story I ran across. It's just too good to tell because it's one of our cherished World War II folks. One of our great generation. His name's Ray Hamley. He was a young 21-year-old during the war. He's English, grew up in a small village. He was trained as a pilot, and he was flying B-25 Liberators over Germany late in the war, flying out of London, did his 25 missions. Most of the people in his air wing died. He survived. At the end of the war, he kind of went back to his life and had life to go back to, which was lovely. Married his childhood sweetheart and became a teacher and then became a principal of a private school. And that was his career. And he remembered vividly the last bombing mission he ran. The war was pretty desperate. England had been bombed repeatedly by the Germans, and now the English and the Allies were having to do the same. They were having to break up all the infrastructure. So he said, my bombing mission was to bomb a railroad. And he said, we did, and we blew it up. And he said, a munitions plant, and we did. And he said, I was always afraid a little bit that my bombs just kind of walked up the street more than they were supposed to. But he said, I didn't know, and we flew home and made it. And then a few years ago, someone saw in the paper an article about Germany and said, Ray, did you see this article about you ran bombing missions over Germany? He said, yeah. He said, well, I'll bring it to you. And it was an article he had missed, and it was about a church that had spent all these years not rebuilding, and finally, you know, 30, 40 years later, 50 years later, had gotten around to rebuilding St. Mary's Catholic Church because it had been bombed. Specific day, specific time. He went upstairs in his footlocker and pulled out his pilot's log. It was his date, his time, his bombs. He had blown up the church. And in the article, it talked about there was an older couple whose kids and grandkids were still in the parish, and the older couple lived next door to the church, and the bombs had killed them, and they were caretakers for the property. And he said something struck him, and it just wouldn't leave him. And he started worrying about it. I mean, really worrying about it. And his wife said, you know, sweetheart, you are a great man. You go to church. He's an Anglican. He's active in his community. He said, it was war. Just kind of let it go. Just, it's okay. It's going to be all right. That was war. They'll understand. Everybody understands. Things happen. But he couldn't let that go. He said, I can't. And so he sat down and he wrote a letter to the parish apologizing for bombing the church and killing those people. And he said, yes, it was in the context of war. And he said, we did a lot of harsh things. But he said, I am very deeply sorry for that. About 2 weeks later, he got back something totally unexpected. It was a letter from the congregation, from the priest. And it was short. It was just a little short note. And it said, Mr. Ray, you know, said simply this, we forgive you. It was signed by 600 parishioners and their children. And at the end of the signatures, it said, would you please bring your family and come to the rededication of our church? You see, I think if we will wait long enough, watch long enough, we will find God moving in our lives. And often at times that we need God most. God is working. Don't ever miss that. That's the gospel. I think we spend a lot of time trying to worry about making God appear. That's not the deal, folks. The gospel said God is always with you. God is there. Maybe we, though, at times need to be struck by that thought. Struck deeply that, yes, God is right here, right now. I'm in the presence of this. And you know, when we're in the presence of God, we know that something we need, something good that someone needs, something to help us move through something, get beyond something, it is going to come. That's the way it works. I hope that today, as we baptize another baby, we've had lots of baby baptisms, and baptize Elizabeth Caldwell, that we will be cognizant of that, that we help her parents and grandparents and godparents and extended family know that God is with her now and always. She need do nothing. But also hope we do also help her wait and watch with us. Because, you know, like Mary and Martha in this wonderful story, we may discover what they found. That, you know, it is actually pretty easy to take Jesus home with you. It really is, because you see, he has always been there. Amen.
Please be seated. The candidate for holy baptism will now be presented.
I present Elizabeth Caldwell Mills to receive the sacrament of baptism.
Will you be responsible for seeing that the child you present is brought up in the Christian faith and life?
I will, with God's help.
Will you, by your prayers and witness, help Elizabeth to grow into the full stature of Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God?
I renounce them.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept Him as your Savior?
I do.
Do you put your whole trust in His grace and love?
I do.
Do you promise to follow and obey Him as your Lord?
I do.
If the congregation will now please stand. And I address this next question to you. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support Elizabeth in her life in Christ?
We will.
Let us now join with Elizabeth, who is committing herself to Christ, and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, life.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will.
Let us now pray for Elizabeth, who is to receive the sacrament of new birth.
Deliver Elizabeth, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open her heart to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill her with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep her in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach her to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send her into the world in witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring Elizabeth to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
That is one serious look. This is cool. We're going to be good. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt. In it, your Son, Jesus, received the baptism of John. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who hear are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Okay, come here. All right, the water's a little colder than I promised. Name this child.
Elizabeth Caldwell.
Elizabeth Caldwell, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I know, that's such an uncomfortable position.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit you bestowed upon this your child, Elizabeth, forgiveness of sin, and have raised her to a new life of grace. Sustain her, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give her an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all of your works. Amen. And now, Elizabeth, sweetheart, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. Amen. All right, and now as dad, and I don't know who all's going, get walk through. All right, there y'all all go. Going to bring her through the congregation. And as they do, let us welcome Elizabeth, saying together, "We receive you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in his eternal priesthood."
Now we ask that you please greet one another with your first name. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Ascribe to the Lord the honor to his name, bring offerings, and come into his courts.
Sweet.
Great Thanksgiving continues on page 361. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit,
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say together,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us eat the feast. Alleluia!
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
communion prayer is found in your order of service. Let us pray. Most loving God, the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Peace, to love, and serve the Lord.